And I will trust you. I will trust you alone.
Trust you alone.
I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy. Sing it out. I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. Isn't he worthy, friends? In the secret, in the quiet place, in the stillness, you are there. In the secret, in the quiet hour, I wait only for you, 'cause I want to know you more. I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more. I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more. I am reaching for the highest goal, that I might receive the prize. Pressing onward, pushing every hindrance aside, yes, out of my way, 'cause I want to know you more. I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more. More and more and more, I want to touch you. I want to see your face. I want to know you more.
Sing it to him as a prayer.
I want to know you. I want to hear your voice. I want to know you more. Jesus, help me too. I want to touch you, Lord. I want to see your face. I want to know you more.
Amen. Yes, Lord.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. For my soul longs and even faint for you. For here my heart is satisfied within your presence. I sing beneath the shadow of your wings. Better is
one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Than thousands elsewhere.
One thing I ask, and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. One thing I ask, and I would see.
Help us by your Spirit, Lord.
To see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells.
Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere.
My heart and flesh, my heart and flesh cry out for you, the living God. Your Spirit's water to my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you.
Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts and thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts and thousands elsewhere. Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day and thousands elsewhere. Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day and thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Than thousands elsewhere.
My strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all.
fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
Sing again. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
Yes, Jesus, you are worthy, Lord. We praise your holy name.
All I once held dear, built my life upon. All this world reveres and wars to hold. All I once thought gain, now I've counted loss, spent and worthless. Now compared to this, knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Now my heart desire is to know you more, to be found in you and known as yours, to possess by faith what I could not earn, all surpassing gift of righteousness, knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness, and I love you, Lord. Oh, to know the power of your risen life, and to know you in your suffering, to become like you in your death, my Lord, so with you to live and never die, knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, there is no greater thing. You're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my you're my all,
you're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my
again,
you're my all, you're the best, you're my joy, my righteousness,
and I love you, Lord. Love you, Lord.
Father, we've been singing True Truth, Lord. It is our heart's desire to know you in a greater and deeper way than ever before. And God, we plead out of your mercy and the wideness of your love, would you pour out your Spirit on us today? The Spirit that will empower us, Lord, that we might know you in a greater and deeper way than ever before. Oh God, we just invite you, come and do what you want to do in our midst. Receive our praise, Lord. We lift to you grateful hearts. You've given us such a Savior in Jesus. Father, thank you for Christ. And Lord Jesus, would you guide us, Lord? Would you teach us? Would you make us, by your Spirit's power, more like you? Help us, Lord, in that. Oh, Father, we just praise you now. God, Abba, receive our praise. Blessed Lord, we just worship you. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. For your seat, you can shake a hand or give a fist bump, and children, you can be released for children's church. Alrighty. Let us be called back to order. If you're using the Pew Bibles, go back one slide for me if you don't mind. I forgot to write it down. Oh, maybe I did 8:14. You're good. Leave it on those slides there. That's great. Thank you. See if 8:14 isn't Matthew 9. Somebody look that up in the Pew Bibles for me. Otherwise, Matthew is the first book in the New Testament. What? 8:14, we good?
8:14,
great. So my sermon research sometimes leads me into strange places. And this week, I happened to find this, a research paper, the title of which is The Pragmatics of Indirect Commands and Collaborative Discourse. That's a mouthful, is it not? Pragmatics of Indirect Commands and Collaborative Discourse. It's a paper about people talking to computers and computers talking to people. But I just highlight this in terms of the grammatical phrase indirect commands. If you've never heard of it before, hear it now. There is such a thing as indirect commands, okay? Now, I don't know if you've had a mom or a dad, maybe a teacher or a coach, who was good at giving you indirect commands, but I've had a few in my life. Now, a direct command is, Jonathan, go take the garbage out. That's a direct command, right? An indirect command is, well, if this garbage doesn't get out, we're not going to eat supper. Anybody ever hear something like that before? A few of us, right? That's an indirect command. Okay? Mom is telling me that I got to take the garbage out if I want to sit down to a nice hot meal.
Okay? But she didn't couch it in the terms of command. She just said, well, this has got to happen before we're going to eat. So indirect commands are definitely, definitely a part of our study of Scripture today. And so we're going to Matthew 9. We're going to read a few brief passages there. But I have a lot for you today, so I just want to warn you to buckle in tight. Hold on, because the roller coaster is about ready to take off, right? But here is the Scriptures for us today. And you're welcome to remain seated as I read just a couple verses here. Then the disciples of John came to him. This is Matthew 9:14. Then the disciples of John came to him, that's Jesus, saying, why do we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. No one puts a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch tears away from the garment, and the worst tear is made. Neither is new wine put into old wineskins. If it is, the skins burst, and the wine is spilled, and the skins are destroyed. But new wine is put into fresh wineskins, and so both are preserved. Let's pray. Father, would you please help us with all the Scripture that you've laid on my heart to share. God, would you help us by your Holy Spirit to be able to receive, to absorb, and then especially to apply your truth that you have for us. I ask, Father, in Jesus' name. So indirect command we're thinking about, right? And Jesus expects us to fast, not once, but at least twice, and there's copies of this in other of the Gospels, so if you add them all up multiple times, this expectation, that clear expectation that Jesus expresses is there for us to grapple with. It says in verse 15 that when the bridegroom goes, then they will fast. Okay, then they will fast is an indirect command to you and to I today. That is my premise, and I'm happy to argue it with you, but I believe it is Jesus' clear expectation that we, as New Testament Christians, we're part of that era since the giving of the Holy Spirit, that Jesus expects that we are going to fast on a regular basis. Okay. Now, I tried to find, again, in terms of my research, some statistics about how often evangelicals fast. My guess is that it's not often at all, right? I would say of our church, just as well as I know the flock here, that we got some fasters in our midst, okay? And that's a wonderful thing. That's a blessing. That's a great thing. But by and large, as I think of the evangelical church as a whole and the evangelical movement, that I don't believe it happens very often. So again, the question is, well, when are they going to fast? It's when the bridegroom has gone. Okay? Is the bridegroom gone right now, friends? Who's the bridegroom? Jesus is the bridegroom. Is he here? No, he's not. Where is he? He's at the right hand of the Father, right? But he's coming back, right? Amen. He's coming back to the church, which is his what? Bride. So if the church is his bride, he's the bridegroom. In the ancient Near East, in the Jewish context, that the bridegroom would go and make preparation for the new home for the bride to go to. You're with me on all that, right? This is the standard practice in Judaism. In Jesus' day, that the bridegroom goes and makes preparation and then comes, and then there's the wedding, and then they come back. Well, first there's the ketubah. There is the covenanting together, the initial covenanting together of the lives, the legal agreement that they're going to be joined in marriage, but then the groom goes away, right? So the groom has gone away. That's the point of all this. So the groom is gone, but Jesus is the groom. And he says, when the groom goes, then they will fast. Okay? Indirect command. This is not optional, friends. This is not optional. We treat it as optional to our own detriment and sorrow, but it's not optional. Okay? The time is now for us to be fasting. And the question is, are we doing it? And again, I believe there's a number of us who do, but by and large, in terms of the evangelical church, fasting is not in fashion. It's not a trending topic on Twitter, okay? And it's not the only time that Jesus clearly expressed the expectation. In Matthew 6, he says, when he's asked about fasting, he says, when you fast, do this. Indirect command. Indirect command. When you fast, the expectation, clear expectation of Jesus, is that we, as his loving followers, are going to be fasters. We're going to do that. So the question is, why do we fast? Well, we fast because Jesus tells us to. And we also do so because Jesus left an example for us. Okay, Matthew 4:2 says, after fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. Now, one of the things I meant to put into this, and I didn't, but there was a news feed this past week. I think it was of a Nigerian pastor. It was an African pastor of some sort who died fasting because he was 25 days into an absolute fast. He had no food or no water. And I think, what a sad thing, because that's not following the example of Jesus, friends. It says after 40 days and 40 nights, he was thirsty. No, it doesn't say that. It says he was hungry. Okay? The idea of a fast in the biblical context, most often that word is of what I would call a full fast, is no solid food, just water. Again, this person died doing an absolute fast. We'll talk about absolute fasts in a moment, okay? But Jesus didn't do that. He left us an example. Jesus fasted, okay? Other nights it says that he spent in prayer. I believe that some of those probably he was fasting. Doesn't say so in the scripture, but in the context of first century Judaism, of a devout Jew seeking the Father, they would use fasting often. So I think Jesus probably did that. Again, clearly in Matthew 4, he's fasting, and in other times, I believe he did. Zechariah says this, is what the Lord, the Almighty says, the fasts, plural, of the 4th, 5th, 7th, and 10th months will become joyful and glad occasions. Now, Jesus lived as an observant Jew, okay? He is the Messiah of Israel, okay? He was tempted in all ways, yet without sin. What does that mean? It means that he lived out the principles and precepts, the law of the Father, perfectly. So when Zechariah says that there's these fasts, did Jesus do it? Absolutely, he did. So Jesus fasted. Okay, that's the example. Not just Jesus. What did Paul do? Acts 13 says this, while they were worshiping the Lord and what? Fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I've called them. So after they fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. Okay? I think Paul is one of those who's fasting in this context. Paul and Barnabas, chapter 14, appointed elders for them in each church, and with what? Prayer and fasting committed them to the Lord in whom they had put their trust. It was Paul's regular practice as a devout Jew, and then he became a Jesus follower of Messiah, that he fasted. What happened in the early church? Contemporary Pharisaical Judaism fasted twice a week. Luke 18, the Pharisee who's in the temple, who's wanting to justify himself compared to the tax collector sinner who's in the temple beside him, he says, I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. Now, he was trying to justify himself before God, which cannot be done, right? We can't earn our way into heaven. It is not by works we're saved, but by grace. But I point this out to say that contemporary Judaism in the day of Jesus, they fasted twice a week. Okay? Do the math on that just really quickly. Say you start at 20 years old and you go to 45 years old and you're fasting twice a week and you have the fasts of Zechariah on top of that. We're talking about 2,700 fast days. 2,700 fast days.
people of God in ancient times fasted a lot. How often do we fast? Hardly ever. And we're a church where it happens quite a bit, I think, okay, comparatively speaking. The Didache is dated around 125 AD. 125 AD, okay? The last of Paul's letter is about 90 AD, okay? Or I should say probably the Revelation, John is 90 AD maybe. Anyway, this is a very, very ancient document. And some people would have argued that it should have been included in the New Testament. It's not New Testament, okay? It does not have the same authority as our scriptures. But it is so enlightening to read through the Didache. That's a kind of use of a Greek word for teaching, to teach, didaskalos, as a teacher. It says this, your fast should not be identical with those of the hypocrites, that would be the Jews who didn't embrace Jesus as Messiah from the Christian perspective of the early church, then they were hypocrites. Here's the Messiah of Israel and you're not embracing him. Okay, that was hypocritical in their mind. Okay, your fast should not be the same as those of the hypocrites. They fast on Mondays and Thursdays. You should fast on Wednesdays and Fridays. This is the early church, 125 AD. This is early in the life of the New Testament fellowship. And what is their practice? Twice a week they're fasting. Okay? So what is fasting? Again, let's look at the various aspects of fasting very quickly. There is such a thing as an absolute fast, okay? No food or water, okay? It can only be for a very brief season. The human body can only survive a few days without water. The only exception to this was Moses spending, and this is my conviction, that he spent 40 days, got the tablets, came down, saw the idolatry going on, threw the tablets down, went back up for another 40 days. That is the only time that you can go any kind of long distance fasting as an absolute fast. Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the highest holy day in the Jewish calendar, is an absolute fast. Okay? The instructions are that you are to not eat or drink for that 24-hour period leading into Yom Kippur, sundown the day before and then sundown of the day. Jonah 3 says this, the king of Nineveh, then he issued a proclamation by the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let any beast, man or beast, herd or flock, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink. So here is scriptural evidence of what's called an absolute fast. No food, no water. Again, can only be done very briefly. I'm saddened to hear of this Christian brother somewhere. I forget where it was, Africa, who died. I think he was mistaken. I don't think God desires that. It's undertaken at the most dire of need. Again, it's a brief but intense expression of repentance and sorrow before God. What I would call just a fast, without giving adjectival distinction, but for sake of delineating between the various ways to fast, again, typically when it talks about fasting in Scripture, this what I will use adjectively, full fast, is no food, only water. And that's, in the ancient world, is typically what is understood when you use the word fast. Matthew 4, again, after fasting 40 days, 40 nights, he was hungry. Jesus, I think, had been drinking from the streams in the wilderness all those 40 days. 40 days is the outer limit of a full fast. After such time, the body has typically used up all its resources and begins to cannibalize itself, eating up muscle tissue, okay? So there's been some people in history who've gone more than 40 days on, you know, hunger strikes and trying to make a point. And again, some people end up just dying from it. So it's not a contest, friends. You know, you don't have to fast 40 days to be spiritual. Fast as the Spirit leads.
A modified full fast would include drinking fruit and vegetable juices, but also it's important to have lots and lots of water. What I would call partial fast, we have evidence in Scripture in a couple places. The Nazirite vow, in my mind, is a partial fast. Number 6 says this, the Lord said to Moses, speak to the Israelites and say to them, if a man or woman wants to make a special vow, a vow of separation to the Lord as a Nazirite, he must abstain from wine and other fermented drink and must not drink vinegar from wine and from other fermented drink. He must not drink grape juice or eat grapes or raisins. As long as he's a Nazirite, he mustn't eat anything that comes from the grapevine. So here is a diet that is restricted in some way, as God has directed. So that's a partial fast. The Daniel fast, I think, is, again, a partial fast early in the book of Daniel when the king's food is set before the Jewish refugees. They say, no, we don't want to eat this. Can we just eat vegetables? And God does that. And I mean, the leader allows that. They prosper. That's a partial fast. And I think God can lead you if you're not able to do a full fast. And for example, we're calling a day of fasting and prayer this coming week. If you can't do that, there might be medical reasons, there might be life issues that you're facing in terms of schedule that you're not able to do that with us. You're welcome to just, fast as the Lord leads, and maybe that's just you're going to avoid certain foods or certain drinks, and God will honor that. God will bless that. Abstaining not only from food or drink, but also activities. And 1 Corinthians is talking about a husband and wife not having physical relation, but only to do so for a short period of time, and to especially use that as a means to be able to devote oneself to prayer. So we can abstain from certain activities, and it can be a form of fasting. Practical how-dos. Drink lots and lots of water. Again, our body is made up of a high percentage. I forget how much of us is water, but it's really high. You need water, friends. Eat smaller meals as you approach the time of your fast, like if you're going to fast for a day or a couple days. Bad idea to just gorge out right beforehand. I mean, that's what we think we ought to do. Like, oh, I'm not going to have food. I got to really, pack in the carbs. Did that, by the way, in terms of training for a marathon, anyway, in terms of healthy ways to fast, you don't want to do that. If you do a full fast for multiple days, then drink fruit or vegetable juices to begin to break the fast, and then eat small healthy meals for your first solid foods. If you fast for multiple days, your stomach actually physically will shrink a little bit. So again, you don't want to gorge out. That's not healthy to do. Ask your doctor about fasting if you have special health needs, and use the time normally spent to eat so as you can pray, read your Bible, and seek the Lord's face. What can we gain by fasting? Okay, that's the how of fasting. The why of fasting is because Jesus tells us to. What's some of the blessing that accrues to us as we fast? There's a deeper form of repentance. 1 Samuel says this, when they had assembled at Mitzpah, they drew water and poured it out before the Lord. On that day they fasted, and there they confessed, we have sinned against the Lord. So fasting is just an outward symbol of this inner reality that we want to seek God in such a powerful way that we're going to do without what we need to live. Again, if you don't eat over a long period of time, you're going to eventually die. You're going to starve to death. So by saying to God, God, you're more important than this stuff that I need to continue to exist. Heightened spiritual awareness. Acts 13 again. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul. So they were fasting God. They were seeking his face. And this incredibly critical direction for the life and the health of the early church came to them in the midst of that setting. Okay, they're seeking God, they're fasting, they're praying, and the Spirit speaks, and there's this acuity of their hearing because they'd been fasting, that they heard from God. So there have been times in my life, friends, when I've had big life decisions to make, and I've used fasting as a spiritual discipline to want to seek God for direction in a greater and deeper way. And it's been a huge blessing in my own life when I've done that. Increased effectiveness in intercession. Ezra 8 says this, so we fasted and petitioned our God about this, and he answered our prayer. You know, so do we go into fasting to force God's hand to give us what we want? That doesn't work well, friends. That does not work well. God is still God, and you can fast till the cows come home. It's a mixed metaphor, isn't it? You can fast all you want. You're not going to force God's hand, okay? It's not this magical thing you do to make the deity bow to your will. No, that's not it at all. Again, it's about seeking his face, wanting to know him in a greater and deeper way, wanting to align oneself with him in a greater and deeper way. And then as we pray, our prayers are effective because we've lined ourselves up with his will. Last week, when we were looking at all the promises of praying in the name of Jesus, ask for anything in my name, he says, and it will be done for you. Again, that's not just tacking the name of Jesus on at the end of our prayers. It is aligning our hearts, our will, our thoughts, our intercessions even, with who the person of Jesus is. Breaking strongholds in the bodily desire, passions realm. Paul says this, no, I beat my body and make it a slave so that after I've preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. I don't know about you, but I'll just be honest and say that sometimes I struggle with food, that I like food. I'm surrounded by a bunch of really good cooks in my home. And so over the course of years, I've developed this habit of really liking food. So when I fast on occasion, it is just a powerful thing in my life. One of the side blessings that comes my way is that I tell myself, I tell my stomach, you're not the boss. Okay? Paul said of the Cretans that their stomachs were their what? Their God. Their stomachs had become an idol. And I think for some of us, we, if we're honest, we'd have that issue. Okay? I'm just trying to be honest about myself. I'm not pointing fingers at anybody. But I've experienced blessing in other areas of my life that I've struggled with in terms of passions and desires, that by addressing the food issue in my life by seeking God and fasting and prayer, that God has brought freedom and release in other areas too. Just something to pray over and consider, friends. So how do we make application? This is a lot of teaching, I realize, and I appreciate your rapt attention. How do we make application of this? It's the old Nike swoosh, friends. Just do it. We need to fast. I believe they are indirect commands in multiple places in the New Testament where our Savior, our Lord, our Master, our King, the authority of our life has said, you need to fast. Okay? It's indirect commands. He doesn't come out and say, you have to fast, but the expectation when you fast, when the bridegroom is gone, then they will fast. He's talking about us, and he's talking about right now. And I think we need to do it regularly. Again, it is out of the norm for many evangelicals, right? But we need to make it a new norm. As the days grow darker, how much more critical is it for us to be seeking God's face like never before? But I do want to encourage us, we need to watch our heart. There was a season in college when I first started learning about fasting and started fasting on a regular basis that I became prideful. I mean, here is a discipline that is especially supposed to humble you, right? No. The twisted way the enemy works in our lives is that he, the enemy, tried to take something really good in my life and make it bad. So we need to watch our hearts. I want to encourage us to press into this. Now, a lot of what I've shared today, I just want to note that 12 years ago to the day, 12 years ago, it was the last Sunday of February 2011, 12 years ago to the day, I preached about this. Right? I used Matthew 6 instead of Matthew 9, but again, I've linked them today. I want us to press into it, okay? I've preached on this, and, you know, I'm not beating anybody up, you know? I just want to note, in terms of our life as a fellowship, how much change did that first message a dozen years ago bring? I preached, we need to fast. And how much fasting has happened between now and then? Okay. Again, I'm not beating you up. I'm just saying, today, we hear the word of God to us. And I want us to be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving ourselves. We need to press into this. And so here is my caution that we need to watch our heart. I believe God will bless us. I believe God will grow us. God will bring great things into our life. But we need to be careful that we don't fall into legalism with regard to this spiritual discipline. Okay? God has made very clear what he wants from our fasting. Isaiah 58, the whole chapter, is so powerful. We have not gotten there. I hope, and it's my fond expectation, that we'll get back to the prophet and finish that book off. But in Isaiah 58, God says a lot. He says a lot about fasting. We're not going to go there and read that whole passage, but I would strongly encourage you to do so in your own devotions. But at one point, God says this: is this not the fast that I chose? He's talking about how the people of God, the Jews, chose to fast on presumably his behalf, for his honor, for his glory, and he found fault with them. Okay, read Isaiah 58. It's a powerful indictment. But in the midst of that, God says, this is the fast that I want. And what is that? To loose the chains of injustice, to set the oppressed free. Share food with the hungry, provide the homeless with shelter, to keep the Sabbath commands. God says in Isaiah 58, you do all this stuff, you're going through these motions, and you think you're doing a great thing, but you're missing the point. The deep point is that I want you to pursue justice in the land. So I want us, and I realize I'm, in a sense, speaking out of both sides of my mouth, I want us to press into fasting like never before, but I want us to do a heart check on a regular basis as we do so. Because it's been my experience, and I've read and seen in church history and other places, where it can become a snare. It can become a trap. It can become something that's legalism and not spirit-driven. The Matthew 9 passage where Jesus talks about fasting, then they will fast, he immediately goes into the whole part of new wine for new skins, right? What is that? That's the Holy Spirit, friends. The difference between Old Testament fasting and New Testament fasting is now we have the Holy Spirit to guide us in all that. Hallelujah. Hey? The Old Testament, the Holy Spirit came upon people, but in the New Testament, the Holy Spirit comes into people. Hallelujah. So we don't have to do fasting in our own made-up way. We can be guided by the Spirit of the Almighty himself. We're going to do this heart check, okay? So I just want to encourage you, if you're able, we've set aside this coming Saturday for a time of fasting and prayer. We'll probably circle up some chairs over here as we do. And it'll be kind of just an open house thing. You can come, stay as long as you want, come even just briefly, but do come. Do come if you're able. We'll have, like, for the time that I'll be here, I'll probably grab my guitar and we can sing and worship. If you bring your scriptures, you know, if the Lord lays a scripture on your heart, you can read that out loud. We'll pray as the Spirit leads. But maybe, again, this is late notice, you may have commitments on Saturday. You won't be able to attend. That doesn't mean you can't participate, friends. You can join us in seeking God, even if you can't be here, even if you can't come. But I feel the call of the head of the church. I feel the call of Jesus for us to run after him, to pursue him with power and passion on our part, to pursue him, seek his face. Why do we fast? Because Jesus commanded it. Indirectly, I admit, that's how it's worded for us in the Bible. But for me, an indirect command from Jesus is more powerful than almost any other command out there. From other sources, I should say. His direct commands are pretty powerful too, aren't they? We fast because God wants us to. And he's not this miserly curmudgeon God. Oh, let's make life miserable for these kids down there. That's not God's heart. He wants us to prosper. He wants us to be blessed. Zechariah talks about the fasts that are called would be times of joy and celebration. That's what the Spirit brings to the process. There is a place for fasting in terms of sorrow and tears and weeping, absolutely. But this is not drudgery that God has for us. This is not punishment. This is freedom and release. How do we fast? We fast God's ways. Okay? He's given us clear instruction in the Word. Some of the how-tos in terms of, okay, I'm going to do a full fast, so I'm going to avoid solid food. I'm just going to drink water. Maybe the Lord will lead me to do fruit juices and vegetable juices. But I'm going to fast God's way. But the most important sense of fasting God's way is to read, to be challenged by Isaiah 58. What is God's heart? With regard to that, I want to reprise a song that I've used once before. John Foreman is the lead singer and writes many of the songs for a group called Switchfoot from California. And they straddled the secular market and also had a presence in the Christian music world. And I really appreciated that position that they took. They didn't promote themselves as a Christian band, but they were a band that often wrote about Christian realities. This song is based on the prophet Amos, and it's rough, but I really felt impressed of the Spirit to reprise this for us today as we close our time studying scripture about fasting and prayer, and as we think about Isaiah 58 and the challenge to pursue justice. I guess I'll leave my comments to that extent and just ask Rob to cue that. And if you don't mind clicking for me, Jen, I'd appreciate that. The words will be on the screen for you. It's a little louder for me.
I hate all your show and pre- hypocrisy of your praise, the hypocrisy of your festivals. I hate all your show, away with your noisy worship, away with your noisy hymns. I stop up my ears when you're singing them. I hate all your show. Instead, let there be a flood of justice, an endless procession of righteous living, living. Instead, let there be a flood of justice instead of a show. Close when you're praying. You sing right along with the band. You shine up your shoes for services. There's blood on your hands. You turned your back on the homeless and the ones that don't fit in your plan. Quit playing religion games. There's blood on your hands. Instead, let there be a flood of justice, an endless procession of righteous living, living. Instead, let there be a flood of justice instead of a show. I hate all your show. Sins of blood red. Let's argue this out. You'll be white as the clouds. Let's argue this out. Quit fooling around. Give love to the ones who can't love at all. Give hope to the ones who got no hope at all. Stand up. An endless procession of righteous living, living. Instead, let there be a flood of justice instead of a show. I hate all your show.
I greatly appreciate the freedom that you folks give me to study Scripture and to bring to you what I feel the Lord has for us. Part of today is a hard word. I understand that. Scripture says that the Father disciplines those he loves. I've known folk who have had parents whose parenting style was laissez-faire. Whatever you want to do, just go ahead and do it. And part of me as a kid saw that and like, man, give me parents like that. Eat candy for breakfast, candy for lunch, candy for dinner. But God in his gracious kindness gave me understanding to know that there was a lack of love in that parenting style. Parents didn't care enough to lay down rules for their kids. Hard word today, in some sense. But don't go away discouraged. Don't go away beat down or beat up. We do have the Holy Spirit, new wine and new skins. Both are preserved, Jesus says. Jesus came to break the mold of many things. Judaism in Jesus' day was very precise and set. And he was not always bound by the societal norms, because he knew better. He knew best. So we're going to close with two songs that talk about justice, being the hands and feet of Jesus. And I want to challenge us. I am happy I preached the message I did 12 years ago, and for whatever blessing that was, for people who heard it then, you've heard much the same today. I'm glad for that. But I want to challenge us to press in, to step into this spiritual discipline. It's out of the norm for many of us. It's out of our comfort zone for many of us. But there's goodness here. I'm happy to share personal experiences with you at a greater length than I have just referenced passingly in the sermon. And there's others, again, I know there's others in this fellowship who know how to fast, who choose to fast. So if you're a total newbie, you don't have to figure this out on your own, friend. There's help, there's guidance, there's encouragement. If you can come Saturday, come be a part of that. If you can fast, great. Do a full fast, great. Partial fast. If you don't do anything but come, that's great too. So I want to pray. And as I do, if the worship team would come join me, we're going to close with two songs. We're going to sing them as prayers that God would guide us and lead us to be instruments of change in a hurting world. Father in heaven, I give you great, great thanks, Lord, for the freedom I do have as a pastor here to look into your word, Lord, and as your spirit directs me to even sometimes preach the really hard thing. And Father, I pray you'd help us to process what we've heard today. And Lord, if it seems like to the flock here that I've been preaching at them, Lord, my heart is convicted. I've been preaching to me, Lord. I hope the dear friends here might sense that. Lord, as we come to these closing songs of praise, would you knit together all the parts of this service that we've been walking through in these sacred moments. We pray for your spirit to quicken to us, Lord, in the word, a couple nuggets of truth that we'll especially seek to apply in the days ahead. Father, I do pray rich blessing, Lord, on the day set aside for prayer and seeking you this coming weekend. Would you meet us in a powerful way, Lord? As we've done this in the past, you've so graciously showed up, Lord. Would you meet us again? Father, I thank you for my church family, Lord. I thank you for brothers and sisters who take seriously their devotion to you, Lord, who seek you in prayer and seek you in the word, seek you in fellowship, Lord, seek you in counsel. And God, we just, our heart's desire, as we expressed it this morning in the early block of praise, is that we want to grow in our knowledge of you, our understanding. We want to seek your face, seek your heart. We come to praise now, Lord. Make these songs prayers. We ask your blessing, Lord. We ask it, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, as we worship, if you have a gift or tithe or offering, you're welcome to come forward. If you have prayer needs, as I mentioned last week, that the elders are very happy to meet you at these front seats and to pray for you, pray with you, anoint you with oil according to the clear instruction of James chapter 5 that we studied last Sunday. But if you have needs, physical, spiritual, mental, emotional, financial, seek the Lord and let us seek the Lord with you. But if you're able to rise to your feet, stand as we sing our closing songs.
Did you feel the mountains tremble? Did you hear the oceans roar? When the people rose to sing of Jesus Christ, the risen one. Did you feel the people tremble? Did you hear the singers roar? When the lost began to sing of Jesus Christ, the saving one. And we can see that God, you're moving a mighty river through the nations, and young and old will turn to Jesus. Fling wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen Lord. Open up the doors and let the music play. Streets resound with singing, songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy, dancers who dance upon injustice. Do you feel the darkness tremble when all the saints join in one song and all the streams flow as one river to wash away our brokenness? And here we see that God, you're moving. A time of jubilee is coming when young and old return to Jesus. Fling wide you heavenly gates, prepare the way of the risen Lord. Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing. Songs that bring your hope, songs that bring your joy, dancers who dance upon injustice. Sing it out as a prayer. Open up the doors and let the music play. Let the streets resound with singing. Justice. One more. more time.
And open up the doors and let the music play. Let our streets resound with singing.
Here in Hoosick Falls, Lord,
songs that bring your hope and songs that bring your joy and dancers who dance upon injustice.
You have shown us, O God, what is good. You have shown us, O Lord, what you require. You have heard all our songs, how we long to worship you. You have told us the offering you desire to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you, God. You said to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you, God. You have shown us the riches of your love.
Hasn't he done that to us, friends?
You have shown us your heart for those in need. Lord, you're opening our ears to the cry of the poor. You have called us to be your hands and feet, to do justly and to and to walk humbly with you, God. You said to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you, God. To the oppressed and the broken, to the widow and the orphan, let the river of your justice flow through us.
Sing that again.
To the oppressed and the broken, to the widow and the orphan, let the river of your justice flow through us. To do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you, God. You said to do justly, to love mercy and to walk humbly with you, God. To do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you, God. You said to do justly
and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you, God, to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you, God.
Oh, Father, you've heard the cry of our heart today, Lord, that you would so work in and through us by your Holy Spirit, that we would be the hands and the feet of Jesus. Lord, teach us more about fasting and prayer. Lord, teach us more about seeking you with the whole of our being, God, to run hard after you, God. Thank you so much for this day. Lord, I pray you'd bless this week ahead. Lord, I pray you'd give us eyes to see the hurt and the need around us, Lord, and the faith, Lord, to believe that you can use us as part of the solution. Father, we pray for Hoosick Falls. I pray that we might dance on injustice, Lord, through and around these streets, God. See you do great and mighty things. Lord, I pray for the outreaches planned in the weeks and months ahead. Lord, would you use us to be a witness, to be salt and light, Lord, in this community. Father, again, we thank you so much for this time. I pray for the fellowship time that follows our service, God, so we have opportunity to converse with one another, to talk, Lord, to hear life stories. Lord, that you would knit our hearts together, closer, a tighter bond, Lord. We just commit our ways to you and ask your blessing. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, friends. God bless you as you go.
Chorus of Did You Feel? Chorus.